Hello, I'm Tom Rothman of 20th Century Fox. Welcome to Fox Legacy. We're glad to have you with us. The Hollywood musical is going through a bit of a revival these days with the success of films like Chicago, Dreamgirls, and Hairspray. And I'd like to think that we at Fox helped initiate this renaissance in 2001 with Baz Luhrmann's Moulin Rouge, a movie that mixed contemporary music and storytelling with the traditional musical form. But before Moulin Rouge, the musical was experiencing a relative drought. You have to go back to 1982 to find the latest boomlet of successful live-action musicals of Annie and The Best Little Whorehouse in Texas. And really, if you look overall, it's since the 1960s, musicals have been a declining presence in Hollywood. Question is, why? Well, in the beginning, in 1927, with the first talkie, The Jazz Singer, audiences fell in love with musicals. And they were a staple here at Fox. Huge portions of Fox production slate over the years were allocated to musicals, featuring stars like Shirley Temple, Don Ameche, and Alice Faye. The 40s brought the era of Technicolor, dominated by Betty Grable, Rita Hayworth, Carmen Miranda. In the 50s, Marilyn Monroe and Gentlemen Prefer Blondes, Ethel Merman, There's No Business Like Show Business. Ain't that the truth? And the hugely popular Broadway musicals of Richard Rodgers and Oscar Hammerstein. Indeed, when the cataclysm that was Cleopatra threatened to bankrupt the studio, Fox sold off half its backlot, which is the land that the buildings called Century City, named for 20th Century, are now built on. And with the last capital left from that, they took a shot and made a little musical called The Sound of Music. That musical, a massive hit and still a perennial, actually saved the studio, put it back on sound footing, and is, I suppose, the only reason I still have a job today. Now, The King and I was fresh off its success on Broadway, where Yul Brynner originated the role of the King of Siam. It's hard to believe that Brynner wasn't Rodgers and Hammerstein's first choice for the role of the King. The two originally wanted Noel Coward, the British actor and playwright, to direct and star in the Broadway musical. But Coward, smart fellow that he was, would only agree to direct if Brynner could play the lead. Even so, when Brynner was first asked, he turned down the audition flat. Finally, after pursuing the reluctant actor for almost 3 months, he relented. Deborah Carr, as the studio publicity machine said, Carr rhymes with star, on the other hand, was the one and only actress considered for the role of Mrs. Anna in the film. The star of movies like From Here to Eternity, she knew a good role the minute she saw one. In fact, Carr said, quote, "This is my role. There will never be another to match it as long as I'm an actress. Mrs. Anna is my Gone with the Wind." In the 1950s, when movie stars took a musical role, they often didn't do their own singing. Soprano Marnie Nixon, who was a ghost singer, you might say, for Marilyn Monroe in Gentlemen Prefer Blondes, Natalie Wood in West Side Story, and for Audrey Hepburn in My Fair Lady, does the singing chores for Carr in this movie. I think the pressure of the celebrity media coverage today would make that impossible. So Nicole Kidman, Ewan McGregor, Renee Zellweger, Catherine Zeta-Jones, Johnny Depp, all do their own singing in contemporary musicals in the last few years. And I think that most modern stars would hesitate to take on a role that they couldn't sing. Now, The King and I was expensive, $6.5 million. At the time, the costliest musical the studio had ever made. If Fox was going to make that investment, it wanted to know that there was going to be a larger-than-life event around the movie. The 1950s were a transitional period in American cinema. Movie theaters had newfound competition, a thing called television. TV was capturing a larger share of leisure time, and studio executives had to figure out how to compete. So they first dabbled in gimmickry, 3D, Aromarama, Percepto.
Warning, this picture is for people with nerves of iron only.
At Fox, though, the engineers created a genuine technology. that would make its films look even more elaborate and spectacular than ever before. More than a gimmick, it enhanced the movie-going experience, making it visually stunning and epic. It was called CinemaScope. This was a process where filming an image was compressed with a special lens that made the image 2.5 times wider than the original. The final technology used in The King and I was called CinemaScope 55, and it gave the system 4 times the image area of the first version. The result gave audiences an experience they could never get in their living room.
Here to tell you about the new CinemaScope 55 is Daryl F. Zanuck, Vice President in charge of production for 20th Century Fox.
CinemaScope 55 represents the very last word in viewing pleasure.
Today, added to the competition of television, not 3 channels, but 300, is the internet, video games, and on and on. So theatrical experience must continue to evolve. Ironically, at Fox, we believe one of the next evolutions will be a return to a concept tried in the 50s, but now perfected with real technology, 3D. James Cameron's next epic for Fox, Avatar, coming at Christmas of 09, will be a 3D stereo vision experience unlike any audiences have ever had. I expect it to raise the bar in the same way that CinemaScope did in 1950s, which, by the way, was usually successful. In any case, whatever the technology with which a film is delivered, if the story itself isn't great, the movie will never endure. The King and I is one of the great stories ever told.
If my Lord in heaven would show the way, every day I do my best for one more day.
The American Film Institute places it in its list of the top 25 movie musicals of all time, alongside Fox's own The Sound of Music, which we spoke about earlier, All That Jazz, and Moulin Rouge. The King and I won a slew of Academy Awards, including Art Direction, Costume Design, Music, Sound, and of course, Best Actor for Yul Brynner. It was a role that never left him. He revisited it twice again on Broadway and also in a short-lived TV series. In 1999, Fox made a new film from the original source material, Anna and the King. It failed. Why? The audience missed the songs. That's not a problem for you tonight. Get ready for a visual treat as we take you back on a journey in time. A grand tale of a king and a teacher, worlds apart in their thinking, yet bonded in trust and respect.
Understanding that this kind of thing can happen.
Shall we dance?
Enjoy the Hollywood musical at its peak. And as to its supposed demise, stay tuned after the movie and we'll find out really what happened from 1960 to today. For now, etc., etc., and so forth. See you after the film. You've just watched a Hollywood musical from the very zenith of the art form. So what did happen to movie musicals from 1960 to today? Where did it go? Well, every year has its zeitgeist. The 60s were about the Beatles, rock and roll, free love, or so I'm told, the revolutionary quest for authenticity. Even advancements in technology couldn't disguise the fact that show tunes no longer appealed to the spirit of the times. The movie musical was too clean, too mainstream. Studios tried to revive it with films like Fiddler on the Roof or Jesus Christ Superstar, A Chorus Line. They had modest or no success. There were only a smattering of traditional hits like 1978's Grease. But note that all the pictures we've been talking about are traditional or break into song musicals. With the heightened realism of entertainment in general in the 60s, this became very difficult for audiences to accept, harder for them to, in the phrase, suspend disbelief. But I would argue that movie musicals never really died, they morphed. into movies with indigenous song scores. The 3F films, for example. Fame, Footloose, and Flashdance, the brainchild of my boss, the late, great Don Steele. I'd argue that A Hard Day's Night or even Purple Rain, like those, are as much movie musicals as, say, Evita. And I would certainly contend that the bounty of song and imagery that began over 80 years ago with The Jazz Singer won't ever leave our screens. It'll just evolve, however digital the delivery may be. At least, I hope so.
Because of all the beautiful and new things I'm learning about you day by day.
For Fox Legacy, I'm Tom Rothman. We'll see you next time.